The first thing I wanted to ask you, I thought about some a bit of a chronological order, because I had so many things I wanted to know. Mm-hmm. So first I wanted to ask you about your childhood years, where where were you born, and maybe to talk about a bit your family and your memories.
Wow. I was born in Boston, Massachusetts, in this country. Excuse me. Memories, there are a great many. I remember particularly that my father liked to take us out into the woods. There were four daughters in the family, and he liked to take one or two of us out into the woods and have us be noticing things.
Right.
And I think that started me looking at what was around me in a very particular way. Not just taking a chair for granted, but looking at the chair and seeing what its history might be and how it might have been used. And sometimes it was cigarette packages on the street, and I would pick them up, and I made a piece out of that. It really started me paying attention.
Mm-hmm. Noticing your surroundings.
Yeah.
So you would say that this already started when you were a child?
Oh yeah, very much so.
And stimulated by your father. And you were also saying something about your babysitter the other day?
Yes. When I was three, my parents went away for the summer, and the woman who took care of us was the librarian at a school. It was, I think it went up to seventh grade or something like that. So she was used to being with children, and she really got me noticing. We were at the shore, and we would turn over a rock and see what scuttled away from under the rock, and we'd talk about it and what it was and why it was there.
And that was at your three, when you were three there?
Three years old.
Wow.
Yeah.
Oh wow, so nice. Oh wow. And, okay, and then when you finished school, what did you study? Or when did you know that you wanted to go into art?
Well, that was much later, but the interest in words,
mm-hmm,
was really even before I could read.
Oh wow.
And my mother would hear me say something and she would write it down.
Mm-hmm.
And there's not very much that still exists from that, but I know that not only was I interested in words,
mm-hmm,
and in using them in funny ways, but also that people would pay attention to me because they found it interesting. So all through my schooling, I was paying particular attention to writing.
All right.
And poetry particularly. And even in college, I more or less majored in writing. And it was developing all during that time. You don't come as a finished writer, you learn and you work on it.
Yes, yes.
So, the visual arts, it's a little more difficult for me to pin down, but I've been married twice, and it was my second husband, Jeff, who was an artist.
Mm-hmm.
And he was a teacher at the university, and he used to take me out to meet his colleagues and see what his students were doing and so forth. And so that's when I really got interested in not only in visual art, like I never started to paint really. What was I going to say? It was what was really interesting and what people were exploring at that time was art as process,
mm-hmm.
and so events, happenings. Alan Capra was teaching at the same university, and Bob Watts and George Brecht, and so I was, it was like putting a lot of yeast into bread.
Oh, it sounds really amazing.
Yeah, and so
you would meet them as well, and would really be there.
I would go to their house and talk about things, and you know, just visit and be friends.
Yeah.
Watts was a particular friend. I didn't know George as well, but I was more in more interested in his writing and more affected by it.
Mm-hmm.
Than almost anybody else. And later, Yoko Ono was a friend, and we had daughters who were about the same age.
Right.
We would sit in the park and the children would play. Most of what we talked about was money and our husbands.
Well, you have to talk about it with someone, right?
Yeah, right. So that wasn't very many years, but I was very interested when her book Grapefruit came out because I was writing things that were very similar.
Yeah.
So we were kind of growing together, and she was better at getting publicity and being seen.
Mm-hmm.
But
would you share work that you were doing?
Oh, sure. Oh, sure. Yeah.
Awesome.
So,
but how? Okay.
I guess what happened for me when I began to be involved with artists who were pushing boundaries,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
was that I was taking my love for words,
mm-hmm.
and putting it into the mix. So a lot of the work that you can see on the walls here and that we've looked at, a lot of it has words or a verbal component.
True.
So many of the things, like the little bone pieces,
mm-hmm.
I would make oxtail soup. And when you have that at a restaurant, they take the bones out. When you make it for yourself, here are the bones at the bottom of the bowl, and you've eaten all the soup, and I start playing with the bones, and pretty soon they look like creatures, and the creatures have stories, and they're very different from one another. So it's like a process of discovery. It's not like I'm putting my thoughts onto something. It's like we interact.
Yes.
Which is fun.
I wanted to ask you about how did from Boston, Boston, right? How did you appear in New York, and how did you also meet Jeffrey? Yeah, I'm really interested.
Well, Jeffrey and I went to the same school. And he was a year ahead of me.
All right.
At puppy school here in Vermont. And
right. Ah,
yeah.
Okay. Well.
And that's where Cy teaches. our lives went in different directions, and I didn't see him for many years. In the meantime, I was married. I lived in Florida. I came back to New York. And I hadn't finished college, so I decided that I would finish college, and I went to the School of General Studies,
mm-hmm.
which is at Columbia, and it's a school for people who are older than the usual college age, and for whatever reason they want to do their degree.
Mm-hmm.
So I went there, and one day I was in the art library. I was taking a course in art, and there was Jeff, and he came over and he called me by the wrong name, and he sort of got it right, but not really. And so I corrected him, and we kind of giggled about it and talked a little about what he was doing, and
yes,
and exchanged addresses and phone numbers. That was in the fall, around September or October, and then nothing else. We didn't call
each
other.
1960.
And nothing else happened. We didn't telephone each other. And the same thing happened in February that we met at the art library. And that time we started to see each other, and we were married in June of 61. It happened very fast, but we knew each other,
yes,
you know,
wow,
for a long time, and kind of had a sense of who the other person was. So that was how we met, and I still was not involved with art very much. I was taking, I think I took a couple of art history courses,
mm-hmm,
but I never had a studio course or anything like that.
Mm-hmm.
My art, I think of it as being more conceptual,
mm-hmm,
than being about an object that you make. It's usually you got the story, or like the chair piece, each chair represents a certain time and a certain what's a good word for it?
Happening or topic or?
Well, topic you could say, yeah. So these chairs are
which we are now sitting on,
yeah.
Which is so nice.
So that's the first one, that's the red one with blue cushion with white stars on it. When you put it up against a white wall, you have red and white stripes,
uh-huh,
with a blue field with stars.
Yes. Yeah, I read about it.
So this one is like the flag. But in this case, what was in my mind was the wars that we were getting into that I felt that we should not be getting into. And so the stars were breaking up and falling.
You want to show this?
Yeah, sure. So this I call, it's attached. I call this one the Betsy Ross, because she was a woman who, I think she made the first American flag, and it was a circle of stars of the 13 colonies, but that didn't fit here, so I made 12 with one in the middle.
At least your take to the, your interpretation.
Well, it was not an interpretation, it was an accommodation to space.
Sometimes you have to be practical.
It is not a reenactment.
All right. So, is there a moment you can pinpoint or that you remember that you can say that Bici Hendricks was born?
As an artist, you mean?
As someone that suddenly started working.
The question doesn't bring an answer. I don't.
All right.
I don't know how to answer that.
Because this is also something I wanted to ask you, because now you are Nye Ffarrabas, mm-hmm. and a lot of your pieces are signed as Bici Hendricks, mm-hmm. and Bici Forbes Hendricks as well.
Yeah.
And
I was married to Jeff when I started actually showing work,
mm-hmm.
so I was using his name. And I actually asked him, should I use Hendricks or should I use Forbes? He said, oh, I think it would be nice if you used Hendricks. And I did. And at some point I realized that I didn't feel that I wanted to use the name that I was born with, which was Forbes. And so I changed it in terms of what I was showing.
Mm-hmm.
That would have been after my first show.
Okay.
And it was much later, after Jeff and I parted, I had gone back to the Boston area. I was living in Cambridge. And it was near my family, and by that time, they didn't know what to make of me. They didn't understand the things that I was interested in,
mm-hmm.
and it was very uncomfortable. And eventually I moved to Vermont. I loved the area where I had been to school, mm-hmm. and I came back for that reason, and I knew people here. And I felt more comfortable, and finally I said, it's time to have my own name, not the name that somebody gave me to be who they thought that I was,
mm.
because clearly I was not who they thought I was. And so I took the name Ffarrabas is, I believe, the Welsh form of the name Forbes, which is Scottish.
Mm-hmm.
And when you think about it, in Scotland they say Ffarrabas.
Uh-huh,
that's
okay.
Forbes. What we say is Ffarrabas.
Mm-hmm.
And that's very close to Ffarrabas.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So, and in Welsh, one F sounds like a V.
Mm-hmm.
So if you want the sound of an F, you have to have two of them. So anyway, I liked that, and then I had to find a first name that would go with it, because Beachy didn't do it anymore. You know, it just wasn't, it didn't feel like who I was. It didn't even feel like a grown-up name. So I thought about it for a while, and then my mother was ill, and she was very old. She was 97, and I said, I can't change my name while she's here, because she would not understand, and it would make her very unhappy.
Mm.
So I waited until she was gone.
Right.
And then I took the name Nye Ffarrabas, but there's only one B in Ffarrabas. It's not Ffarrabas. A lot of people think it's Ffarrabas, and then they think I'm from the Middle East, and then they think I'm a terrorist. And I don't think I'm a terrorist.
I want to think you're not as well.
Thank you.
Or you're hiding very well.
No, I am not hiding that. I'm not so good at hiding, really. But I like the name. I thought, that's a good name for a writer.
Mm-hmm.
So I was pleased with it. I think both parts of it are Welsh. I have a Welsh friend who is not sure that's true, but maybe it's Old Welsh.
Maybe, yes. Yeah, I wanted to ask you as well, related to this period that you were in New York.
Yeah.
How did you, your memories about your experience as a woman artist, that moment, a bit before the Jackson exhibition, which I will also ask you about.
Yeah, Well, this isn't about New York, but it's about the time that I was in New York. Jeffrey and I went to Cologne, Germany, to the Happening and Fluxus retrospective. And he had a cubicle, and I had a cubicle. His work, my work, very different. His name on that and my name on the other. And people would come up to me and say, oh, wasn't it nice that you could come with your husband? And they didn't even know that I was an exhibiting artist. That's what it's like being a woman in the art world.
At that time.
At that time, and I'm not sure how different it is now. I don't know. But I've been kind of out of the loop for a good many years, because when I left New York, Jeff said my marriage was already finished and I took the children. And he went great guns after his, that means very enthusiastically, after his art career. And I raised the children. Mm-hmm. Now, some people manage to be artists and do that too, but that's not where my attention was. And I was back in the Boston area, which is much more conservative, or it was at that time. And so even if I showed things to people, same thing when I moved to Brattleboro, if I showed my work to people, they'd say, oh, this is not great interest.
Does juice really look different in a tall glass?
Oh, but they wouldn't even read the piece. And that's pretty simple compared to some of my work.
Yes. Yes. So,
yeah, I feel like if you have a deck of cards, the women, and if that's the art world, the women in it are sort of at the bottom of the deck, and you don't get to see them as much. Now, yoga was very good about getting seen, particularly, of course, after John became part of her life. There were women who were good at doing the art world, and I didn't know anything about it or anything about publicity or making things happen. I made my art happen. But it's a different skill set to make the work than it is to get it out there and get it publicized. And I did not have the second skill set. And I was very lucky to connect with Cy and Adam, because they immediately got what it was and were pleased with it and wanted to get it seen.
Yes, they could see, yes, excited at being the owners of the Adam CX Gallery in Brattleboro. I think as many of us could see the value in your work, so they are interested on spreading it and bringing it back.
Yeah.
So more people get to know it and to see it. So
it was much easier in New York. People were thinking in those directions much more.
Mm-hmm.
Not everybody in New York, but there were more people who were. But New York and New England, not so much. I mean, New England, not so much.
Mm-hmm.
New York, yes. And I was so happy that I was able to be part of the Happening in Fluxus retrospective. That was great.
Yes?
Yeah.
Why? What is it you remember?
It was dozens of other artists, all of whom were doing exciting things at the edge.
Mm-hmm.
it was just nice to know there was a community, mm-hmm. even if we weren't living in the same country.
Yeah, because I can imagine on that show there were also international groups from, from Japan and Europe as well.
Yeah, yeah.
So that you met them.
Yeah.
So you really felt a sense of community.
Oh yeah.
All right. That's
I talked a lot with George Brecht, and I talked a lot with Ben Vautier, mm-hmm. and also Carolee Schneemann, mm-hmm. mm-hmm. and you know other people. It was really nice.
Wow, that's really great.
Yeah.
And did you think that this, what you were doing and what you were involved at that moment, would it have such a big impact in history, or it was?
I don't think we thought about that very much. Mm. We were more in the moment.
Yes.
Which is kind of, I think a fair number of us weren't necessarily scholars or deep practitioners of Zen, but we were mm-hmm. aware of a Zen way of looking at things.
So really being present, and yes. Mm-hmm. It's good that you bring it about, because I also had it as one point to talk about, because I think it's really interesting that you went through this period and that you also incorporate in your work, and that you there were also other artists who were also in the same page mm-hmm. as you. Mm-hmm. So how did you first come in contact with this?
Mostly through being introduced to people by Jeff and going to whatever was going on in New York. We mm-hmm. would go out for the evening to somebody's presentation. Capra's Spring Happening was the first thing like that that I ever went to. It was like, oh my God, wow.
Oh.
It was something, it was a big environment, and you walked through it and up a ladder and over a catwalk and down a ramp, and there were different things going on. I remember particularly the rattle of milk bottles. In those days, people still remembered the milkman coming to your door with glass bottles that would rattle.
Uh-huh.
And so there was that sound, and there was the smell of bacon frying. It was like a spring morning. And people getting dressed and, you know, just sort of the ordinary things that people do, but it was like putting a spotlight on them.
Yes.
And you would walk through it and experience it. And I loved that. I really loved it.
That's really great, and that you could have been, that you were there at that moment, I think. Yes,
it was wonderful.
It's wonderful.
Yeah.
You could really experience it there. And that, there were also this sense of community in that sense, that you could all learn and get inspired from each other.
Oh, yeah. Yes, throughout history, when there's been a movement in art, mm-hmm. that's what it's been. It's been people talking to each other about what they're doing and looking at each other's work mm-hmm. and enjoying and competing and doing all the things that people do, you know, just around a similar kind of, not necessarily similar work, but the word ambience comes to me.
Mm-hmm. Yes, and learning from each other and sharing.
Yeah.
I think this is very, very a quality from being involved in a group like this, and that you can really share and that you can learn from each other and inspire each other and be a better person or a better artist as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's good.
I also wanted to ask you, this is something I really like, about the Black Thumb Press. And
a lot of people were doing mail art.
Mm-hmm.
Sending postcards or sending little objects. I had an idea of sending water in letters. I'm not sure I actually managed to do that, and it wouldn't be legal now. But I thought if I sealed it in a very small plastic bag, it might be interesting to mail it. I can't remember whether I tried or didn't. But anyway, it was using the mail as a medium for small works. Mm-hmm. And again, I was interested in words as well. Mm-hmm. You've seen some of the cards.
Mm-hmm.
There would be maybe an image, like I had one that was a circle.
Mm-hmm.
It was a disc of yellow on a white card, but it was, what was the words that went with that?
Oh, I really remember the one that, yeah, either the yellow egg or the yellow line.
Yeah, there was, actually there were two lines, two yellow lines, mm-hmm. and they made kind of an egg shape.
Mm-hmm, yes.
Indeed. And it was either think some more about eggs or very large egg. Oh, it was very large eggs that get opened. That was the piece.
And then you would send one per time? One piece?
One at a time, yeah. I would do that one, and then a month or so later, another one would come up. And Jeff and I did it together. So both of our names are on each card, at least at first, but one card would definitely be his and one would definitely be mine in terms of who thought of it.
Yes. Yeah.
I was very interested in the practice of sending holiday cards.
All right.
And so we did holiday cards together. That was a collaboration that we did, and I would maybe write a haiku and he would do a little line drawing with a brush to go with it. And so each year we would send out something like that. And then in the Vietnam time, when I was growing up, when somebody died that you knew, you would get an envelope, and inside the envelope would be a card with black lines around it.
Mm-hmm.
And, or it, maybe even the envelope had black lines, so mm-hmm. that you knew it was about death.
Yes.
And so one year we sent, I think it would have been about 1967 or 68, 67 I think. I designed one that was, it was the same size card as the others, but black line around it, and it said in black in the middle, in a very small type, it said, Merry Christmas. And with that, I put a printing of a collage from, it was scenes from the Vietnam War, and it was scenes from America flag waving like crazy.
And so simultaneously events.
Yeah, so they were colliding with each other.
Yes.
And that went with the card with the black. So sometimes it was New Year's cards, sometimes it was Christmas cards. And then one of the mailing cards that we were talking about said, I'm having trouble remembering the exact words, but the idea was Christmas in July, because...
Oh, yeah, and with the calendar.
Yeah.
Yes,
yeah.
Yes. So making fun of this, all the Christmas cards.
Yeah, right.
And what can you say about the summer, how is it called exactly? The Summer Institute of Human Relations. Because this sounds more like you wanted to create a platform to provide some sort of service or to share ideas. It sounds a bit more different than what you were doing with the male art.
This wasn't intended as male art. Mm-hmm. It's possible that we sent some to people.
Mm-hmm.
But again, Jeff was a teacher, so he had mm-hmm. the summer off. And we would go up to Canada, to Nova Scotia, and spend the summer there
mm-hmm.
in farming country. And where did I start? What was it?
The human relations.
Oh, right, yeah. Right. So there was this academic entity in the background all the time,
yes.
And I decided to do what I would call a summer institute with little courses, and the courses were events for people either to think about or to try to do. And some of them were not possible. Some of them were sort of possible, like drive around a clover leaf intersection of a highway for 4 hours, just keep going around and around the clover leaf. You could do that, but it was unlikely. And many, many other people had other kinds of things like that that they were putting out. I had one that was swim for an hour in your own blood, internal or external. You know, I don't think anybody did that one either. Or be a potato for several days. So that's the kind of thing, you know. One was to stand on the platform of the subway at rush hour in the morning, dressed dressed in gift packaging. So it was like a big present, but there was a person inside of it.
Oh, wow.
Or flood the subway with Coca-Cola.
Oh, that would be cool.
Yeah, I like that one a lot.
Oh, wow.
And of course it would short out and everybody would be electrocuted if they didn't die from the sugar.
Oh.
It was just, you know, it was silliness, but there was usually something behind the silliness.
Well, it's playfulness that is characteristic from your words, mm. which I think is really nice.
Thank you.
Yes, and it's, again, having this curious eye mm-hmm. into everyday life and situations and surroundings. How do you deal with that as a person, as an artist?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I also wanted to ask you about this first show in Judson Hall Gallery with Joe Hendricks, because I read this article about it and it sounded like it was quite in very short time.
I had 3 weeks to put it together.
And you were also pregnant.
I was.
Or you had
I
already.
Was, I was quite time. Pregnant.
You were quite pregnant.
Yeah.
Indeed.
6 or 7 months.
Wow.
Seven or eight, actually. My son was born in early February. And
yeah, the show was December to January.
That's right.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
So Jeff and John Hendricks both were very helpful in building certain parts of the... I did two... Well, I don't know what you'd call them, two little booths.
Yes.
One was black with a roof on it and a black curtain and a blackboard and black chalk. So a person could go in, close the curtain and write on the blackboard with black chalk.
Mm-hmm.
And there was an eraser, so they could erase it if they wanted to.
All right.
But nobody would know what they had written. And so they could just go and write anything and then come out and somebody else would go. So that was the black booth. There was also a white booth, which had a very bright light overhead, and there was inside the booth was a vanity table, such as a woman would sit at to put her makeup on, and it had a round mirror and a mirror surface. And there were two saucers, white saucers. One had a white egg on it, and not cooked. And the other had a spool of white thread and a needle. And there were instructions. One was balance an egg, so it would stand up on end.
Mm-hmm.
And the other was thread a needle. And that was the white booth, and it had a white curtain too. And those had to be built. And Jeff and John really were very helpful putting all of that together, carrying things down. I had several ice pieces.
Yes.
And so if the show was all weekend, like 3 days, I had to come down from 104th Street to 4th Street with frozen pieces. Jeff would drive in the car, and they had to be made every night. And then the next week on the weekend we'd do the same thing. Now, not only was I pregnant, but I had a 2.5-year-old.
Yes, and this was a second child.
Yeah, right. And of course, when children are 2.5, they run everywhere.
So you were bringing him with you.
Her.
Oh, the
daughter is the older.
Yeah.
Yeah. And one time we were crossing Sullivan Street right next to the church, and she started to run out in the street, and there was a car coming, and we got her, and she didn't get hit. But, you know, we were coping as parents of small children, too.
Yes.
And it was an interesting time, and people really pitched in and helped.
Felt that there was, again, this sense of community where we really supported.
Yeah.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah, well, John was in charge of the gallery, so that was very helpful.
Mm-hmm.
And we're just, you know, very deeply good friends and still are.
Oh,
that was a long time ago, because the baby who wasn't born yet is now 51.
Are you still in contact with him? Or
with John?
Yes.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
That's great. It's good to keep that.
Mm-hmm. Very much so. Yeah, he's very special to me.
I can imagine that. You
he gave me my first show. That was just wonderful.
Wow.
So what else would you like to know?
Now we also touched upon the topic of your children.
Mm-hmm.
And on the opening of your retrospective here at the gallery,
mm-hmm.
You were saying how having children really also had an impact, or how children makes you look different to the world. And I wanted to maybe for you to share a bit about that, and also the poem you wrote. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, my daughter came first, and why did I start to tell you that? When I was growing up, my father was a doctor, and he was born in 1882. That's a very long time ago. He would be in his 130s now, if he were alive. But he would talk about childbirth as being dangerous, and well, of course it still is, it can be, but one was never sure that one was going to live through it. And so I went into the labor room with this understanding that I might not come out alive because of his orientation in the past. And I was writing a letter to Jeff's brother's wife, a different brother. And I said, you know, I really thought that I might be going to die. And I did. And then I explained that when I came out of the experience, I was in a whole different set of roles. It was like I was a different person. So the person I had been before had died, and I had a new personality.
After your first child?
Yeah.
All right, so there was already a rupture over there that you, yeah, that's something that...
It's like a change of scene. Mm-hmm. Like the camera stops and then starts shooting something else.
Oh wow, I didn't know about this.
Yeah. I wrote a poem about that time that was, I couldn't say it off the top of my head, but basically the imagery was, do you know about the samurai swordsmen with their incredibly sharp swords?
Oh, they, yes.
And they would throw up a silk scarf and cut it in half as it was floating down. And that was the image of childbirth for me.
Okay.
Like, we had been together and then we were apart. Mm-hmm. The mother and the child. And it was like bisecting the scarf in the air.
Wow.
And then I wrote one about my son. If I walked down the street as completely as my two-year-old son, I would never get to the end of the block. Because he noticed everything. You know, he had to pick up a little piece of broken glass or a playing card or, you know.
Yeah.
And it was somewhat after that that I was picking up cigarette packs that became part of that piece in there. Much later.
So it really had an impact.
Oh, sure.
Or maybe it intensified your curiosity or gave you some more freedom to
Right. Seeing things through their eyes.
Yeah.
Newness. Everything new.
Yes. Oh, that's very, very beautiful. That's really nice. Okay, so I found this. This has been said by you. I read it in the catalog from the exhibition. I first want to check the camera. Still okay.
Yes, that's right.
Okay. So this has been said by you, and I read it on the catalog from the exhibition here, the retrospective, and it says, "What an artist can do could be subtle, sweet, and simple, and iconoclastic, without needing to be a grand idea or the next big thing." And
I don't remember writing that.
Oh no! Okay, we will find it.
Sure.
But I find this very, very interesting, and I really like it myself very much, because it gives a lot of freedom, and also it doesn't have this pressure of art being such a big intellectual thing. And
this was not an intellectual time.
Yes, it's
for people like this, experimental.
Yes, like I also have something written that it says, I work with what is around me, its way of engaging with the world in an experimental, questioning manner, such as a baby puts everything in its mouth to know what it is.
Yeah.
I wanted to link this with the children part. But I wanted to ask you if your aims or the reason why creating work has changed since you were doing it in that period and while you are doing it now, if it changed.
Well, one thing that is very different, besides the fact that Southern Vermont is not like New York in almost any way, but one part of that is that there is no community for the kind of ways that I think and the things that I do. So I'm doing it in isolation or sometimes by memory, but I'm still in the present with things. It's just a different present. But very much solitary. And it's lovely to be able to show the work, because that's the only way that, you know, there's no getting together with somebody and talking about it over lunch and looking at each other's work. That has not been happening for me here.
And maybe you have to make it happen.
Or maybe it's just fine the way it is.
Or, yes.
But sometimes it's lonely.
Yeah. I'm sure you could find people who are maybe feeling like this and to talk about it.
But I think people who have the same kind of perception are doing other things about it than the things that I think of to do.
I'm positive you will find someone, or maybe we can do something together.
Whatever. I do find some people like the work and are interested.
But really talk about it. And what you were saying, that you would like maybe to have some sort of discussion about it or feedback or...
Yeah, it's not like... you know, when I was friends with Yoko and George Brecht and other colleagues of Jeff's at Rutgers, and other artists whom I met, I didn't meet a big cadre of women artists. I did know some women who were artists, but. It was kind of before the feminist consciousness really started to rise, which would have been around the end of the 60s, early 70s. So there was a lot going on before that. For instance, the word work box in there with the messages that go around, one of them, I think that one says, gives birth, gives death. That was something that I realized. Everybody was talking about giving birth. Oh, well, if you bring a human being into the world, they're going to die. So if you give birth, you give death. So gives birth, gives death. Change is life breath. Earth, now that says Earth man, holy passenger, flashing lightning, spotted messenger. And after I began to have a feminist consciousness, I would never have said it that way. So I've changed it to Earth passenger instead of Earth man. But I can't I can't make new tapes because the company doesn't make them anymore. So that persists from that time of the early 60s. And I would now say it differently.
Yes. You're aware of it, so.
Yeah.
Could you say what drives you to make work or to write, or what inspires you?
Oh my goodness. What inspires me to take the next breath? I guess it's a certain amount of CO2 in my lungs. And the fact that there's oxygen outside that I can get by breathing in. That's a question that wants an intellectual answer, and I do not have an intellectual answer for it.
Oh, I'm really open for anything.
Oh, I understand that, but the question itself feels like it needs a rational response.
Yeah, but come on.
Is it a feeling in the pit of my stomach, or is it something that floats by in the air, or is it a taste that I'm remembering? Mm-hmm. I don't know. Actually, somebody interviewed me for the newspaper here, and she asked me a similar question. It was put a little differently. I can't come up with the words, but it was, how do you get your inspiration? And I don't like the word inspiration at all.
All right.
Because that sounds very much like Victorian poets in England, mm-hmm. talking about going into the Cotswolds and looking at nature and being inspired.
And like,
oh fuck, you know. So what I said to her, which I will have a comment about afterwards, but what I said to her was, if I knew that, I would patent it. Well, I was just being flip, because I really don't think that patenting things, which is like keeping the money that you might get kind of thing. So I don't think of it as inspiration in a Victorian sense, mm-hmm. but I do think of it as something that stops your breath. Oh, you know.
So like noticing something.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Watching a butterfly emerge from a chrysalis. You know, something amazing. And there are many amazing things that happen every day.
So really being able to see those things, I think it's really, it's a certain mindset. Because those things are happening every day, but not everyone is able to really see them.
Yeah.
I'm appreciative.
Yeah. And some of them happen when you're driving to work and you don't notice because you've got to get there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I'm sort of sprung from the driving to work mind.
I'm
in my mid-80s, and I'm not driving to work.
So the world is your oyster.
I hate oysters.
Oh, I don't like them either, but... in 50 years, or in 100 years, how would you like to be remembered?
I would like to be remembered as part of a movement, mm-hmm. Fluxus obviously, but also things that were around Fluxus. There's something in the catalog book that went with my show here.
Yeah.
Oh, I know. Somebody asked Emmett Williams, who was one of the very early Fluxus artists, and very brilliant, who was also a word person. They asked him to give them a definition of Fluxus.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, if you can define it, it isn't. So, I don't think of Fluxus as something that you can draw a clear line around. It's permeable. And much of my work, I would say, was outside. If there was a line, it would be outside it. But I'm still the same person whether I'm doing what I think is a flux work or what I think is not. I don't really think about that very much.
Mm-hmm.
But I very much enjoy being part of a group of people that had similar sensibilities, similar thoughts and feelings and ways of expressing. But I'm also a person who goes ahead and does my things on my own.
Mm-hmm.
And as I've said earlier, I don't have a group here to do that with. So I just do it anyway. How would I like to be remembered? I would like to be remembered. That's not necessarily going to happen.
Well, but we are just posting this question on the table.
Yeah. Okay, can I brag a little bit? I was talking to two men. They were the sons of Sidney Janis, who had a very important gallery in New York City at the time. And their father was getting older and he was away, and they were keeping the gallery going. And I think it was Conrad, but it might have been his brother Carol, said, third, Hendricks. He said, well, of the three of you, it's your work that I remember and respect. That didn't make me a member of Castelli Gallery, but it felt very good. It really felt good because I had been in Jeff's shadow so much. It felt great.
I'm sure this is not the only person who believes this. You should be proud for yourself, what you accomplished and what you are now.
Yeah, I don't know about the word proud, but I know what you're saying.
Mm-hmm.
But sometimes I feel complete.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes I feel that I did what wanted to happen. I made it happen.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel good about it. But not, you know, being puffed up and vain. Not like our current occupant of the White House.
Different people, different attitudes.
Yeah.
All right. Well, I would like to thank you very much for your
thank
time.
Thank you for your interest and your very, very nice way of approaching the work. Thank you. It's lovely to meet you and to get to know you a little bit.
Same.
Yeah.